Good to see each of you. And Travis has an outline for you. If you didn't get one, they're inside the bulletin. And I would like to get that to you. Back in early August, I was asked to give a plenary session at our IABC, that's International Association of Biblical Counselors, conference in St. Louis. Dr. Eirich, who was our interim president at that point, had asked me if I would do a plenary session on hope. I was all excited about it. And then he finished it off. He said, I'd like you to do it on hope during suffering. Oh, okay. So I was happy to do that, but I have to admit it's one of the more difficult subjects to preach on. Because whether it be physical, mental, or emotional, few, if any of us, would eagerly sign up for a lifelong course on suffering. The trials and tribulations of suffering typically come far more often than we would prefer. Yet the Apostle Paul in Romans 5, 1-5 commends the value of suffering and how it begins a process that produces hope. This session, as I mentioned to the folks that were there in St. Louis, will observe 7 important principles and practical steps that will provide hope to those whom we are serving as they implement these important truths. So the whole conference, it was interesting. There were 7 plenary sessions. It was all on hope, and there was hope during grief and suffering and so forth. And like most of us, suffering is probably not our favorite topic. Hope for the suffering. That was my topic. Like most of us, suffering it's not an easy subject. And if we speak on this subject or counsel others who are in the middle of some type of suffering, we realize it's like preaching about the importance of patience. Because you preach on that, you recognize God's going to probably put you through a process of learning about patience if that's the subject. And of course, similarly, if you preach on suffering, I think if it's kind of like throwing a boomerang out there. If I throw that boomerang out there, it's probably going to come back to me. So I want to be very careful. And I was very careful there in St. Louis as to how I came across it. If you aim it at just listeners only, just recognize it's going to come back to you. And certainly I would prefer not to have to practice what I preach. But suffering is part of what we sign up for as a Christian. So when counseling those who are suffering, I gave 7 principles. And the first 2 are not found in this text. But as I spent a long time in preparing for that plenary session, I felt like these 2 were very important. Principle number 1, go slow, take it nice and easy. Go slow, take it nice and easy. Why should we go slow? Because we don't know. We don't know all the ins and outs as to why God has allowed the person we might be helping to suffer. We could be right about a few things, but desperately in the dark about all the factors that God, in his sovereignty, is using for his purposes. For example, we might observe a believing wife who is stricken with cancer. Among the many possibilities could be that God is working behind the scenes to draw her unbelieving husband to saving faith in Christ. I've seen that happen. Add to this a multitude of ways God is working in the lives of our children, relatives, neighbors, co-workers, and others. And yet Deuteronomy 29:29 is so essential to have in what I call our counselor's toolbox. Quote, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our sons forever, that we may observe all the words of this law. End quote. So there are many things God, in his infinite wisdom, says, this is none of your business. I have all eternity to reveal to you the mysteries of life that surround this kind of suffering. This matter is on a need-to-know basis, and at least for now, you don't need to know. You don't live very long here in the Patuxent Naval Base area without, I've had a number of times where I've asked some of our Navy personnel, Marine personnel, well, where did you go? And I kind of found out it was on a needs-to-know basis, and I oftentimes didn't know exactly what they were doing. It's on a needs-to-know basis, and that's certainly true about God. So go slow, take it nice and easy. So go slow, like being in a construction zone. There's lots of moving parts, lots of concrete barriers. Do not make a mistake because you're driving too fast. Pay close attention to everything around you. As James 1:19 says, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Proverbs 10:19 says, he who restrains his lips is wise. And Proverbs 17:27 affirms when it states, he who restrains his words has knowledge, and he who has a cool spirit is a man understanding. I want you to think just for a moment, going back to the book of Job. Remember that? It's one of the oldest books in the Bible. Here's Job, and his three friends see the terrible suffering. And here's what the early parts of Job tell us about these friends. Now, when Job's three friends heard of all this adversity that had come upon them, they came each one from his own place and made an appointment together to come to sympathize with him and comfort him. When they lifted up their eyes at a distance and did not recognize him, they raised their voices and wept. Then they sat down on the ground with him for 7 days and seven nights with no one speaking a word to him, for they saw that his pain was great. So far, so good. Job, these three counselors, they're ready to be signed up for being certified counselors with the International Association of Biblical Counselors, right? They look, hey, they're coming and weeping, spending 7 days and seven nights. But it doesn't take very long where Job has to rebuke them in chapter 13, verses 12 to 15. He says, your memorable sayings are proverbs of ashes. Your defenses are defenses of clay. Be silent before me so that I may speak. Then come on me what may. Though he slay me, I will hope in him. That was the proper counsel, of course, that Job didn't give. So principle number one, go slow, take it nice and easy. Principle number two, be careful not to prejudge. Yes, we should first come alongside those who are suffering. Sure, as much as possible, we should learn the immediate context of their particular circumstances. Words like, I'm so sorry, pause, and then if appropriate, we can gently ask, can you tell me what happened? I don't know how many times over the years, be it visiting someone who's in an automobile wreck or the sudden death of a family member, those were similar words that I've had to use. The close friend or relative may burst into tears as they give you a summary like, my daughter is barely alive because of a terrible auto accident. These were the kind of words I said to many friends and loved ones when my own 16-year-old daughter nearly died on October 26th, 1996, just a few days ago. I called Kendra in Denver, and we talked about the fact it's 23 years ago since that terrible accident. None of these friends during that time probed too deeply. The facts about the accident took time to unravel. She was driving in a construction zone and overcorrected and made a rookie mistake that nearly cost her life. They had to revive her more than once at the scene of the accident. To this day, she lives with the effects of TBI, traumatic brain injury, slurred speech, and limited ability. She was in a coma for 3 months and walked out of Craig Hospital exactly 6 months the day after she had the accident. It's absolutely remarkable to the degree of her recovery after losing virtually all of her memory. She had to completely relearn the alphabet. She graduated from high school, later from college, and enjoys doing Bible studies with others in her Denver apartment complex. But there are hundreds of questions that will not be answered on this side of heaven. Why would the Lord allow a straight A 16-year-old to have to endure a lifetime of difficulty? I talk to her almost every week. And it's a lifetime of pain. It's a lifetime of saying, you know what? I'll never be like I was. And yet she has enough memory to recognize all that she's. By the way, I've dealt with some family members where they've had a brain injury so significant that person doesn't even know what they lost. Part of Kendra's dilemma, she knows exactly what she's lost. And she lives with that every day. But I do know that he does all things well, and by God's grace, we as a family have not questioned his sovereign plan. Instead, we have chosen to cooperate with God rather than to chafe at his leading. Just this morning, Kendra sent me a beautiful picture of the mountains. She's in the 10th floor of an apartment there in South Denver, a beautiful picture of Mount Evans. And that's part of the reason we can't get her to move here to Maryland, because she loves that view she sees every morning. Summary: remember that suffering has a context, varying types of circumstances, and God may not choose to reveal all the reasons for why some are in a place of suffering. Sometimes we are not made aware of all the details until a great deal of time passes by. As such, be ever so careful not to prejudge. For example, are they suffering with lung cancer because of a lifetime of smoking, or do they have lung cancer caused by their heredity or other circumstances? My mother-in-law died of lung cancer, and she never smoked a cigarette in her life. Even the doctors were a little bit perplexed. How do you get lung cancer? Well, it is possible. John 11:35 is one of the shortest verses in all the Bible. It says, Jesus wept. We would do well to come alongside and weep with those who weep, as Scripture says. Later on, the Lord will undoubtedly give us opportunities to provide encouragement and hope by sharing biblical passages that apply to their situation. We were helping our second son move into his house and the setting there at his church in Kalamazoo, Michigan. It just so happened that we took a flight to Detroit and had a long layover. And I remember that day, there was just nobody in this particular concourse. And so I was sitting there studying, and I forget what I was studying, something for here probably. And all of a sudden I looked up, and it was unmistakably Johnny Erickson Tata. And she's walking by herself with her husband. And I said, how many opportunities am I going to get like this to go up to Johnny Erickson Tata? And so I basically did that and went and introduced myself, thanked her for her wonderful testimony that influenced my daughter Kendra's life. She kindly said, can you walk with us as we go to baggage claim? So she and her husband Ken were walking toward baggage. She'd just come off a very tiring trip, had been speaking in Nashville, as I recall. But she genuinely listened during that 10-minute walk and made me feel like it was an honor to speak with me. Her struggle and journey are well documented, and God has given her a global stage to share how the Lord is bigger than all of her trials. Still, while she would have an accident diving in the Chesapeake Bay, you know, I've been here, done fishing, boating, gone to that beautiful portion, and that accident happened actually very close to here. She's bound to a wheelchair for the rest of her life. It remains to some degree undisclosed as to exactly why would God do that, although we see the global impact of her ministry. We see the marvelous fruit God has used for his glory. And just recently, as Johnny was interviewed by John Ankerberg, she said, quote, I had to learn the importance of focusing on living instead of dying. That took time in her life. Let's be careful not to rush God's learning lessons as we come alongside the suffering. So be careful, principle two, not to prejudge. Here's an example. Our own dear Roy Pressler, gone to be with the Lord in glory today, having a whole lot more fun than you are here today. Someone who just learned about his terminal illness, Sue and I had the privilege of taking he and Catherine to dinner. They end up paying for dinner. But the initial focus was on celebrating his wife's retirement from teaching, 25 years. Then toward the end of the conversation, ask if there was any update on all the tests he'd taken, and that's where he disclosed how difficult a situation he had. And I asked him if he'd be interested in the James 5, 13-18 anointing and prayer by the elders. Immediately was very pleased, came to our house that Friday evening for a meal with the four elders and their wives, and the elders had a wonderful time of prayer for both he and his wife. Here's the application of these first two principles. Go slow. Take it easy. Nice and easy. And be careful not to prejudge. We needed to take our time coming alongside them. We didn't know exactly what the etiology was going to be of this difficult illness. We didn't know. And we pray that God would give us wisdom in knowing when to share other important passages like what I'm going to share with you today, Romans 5:1-5, to share with them the glorious truth of having been justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. But for now, Scripture says there's a proper time and procedure. I love this verse, and so many times I've got this wrong, and we can easily do this. Ecclesiastes 8:5-6 says, for a wise heart knows the proper time and procedure, for there is a proper time and procedure for every matter. I've got this wrong at times. I've had to ask for forgiveness. So in summary, I want to get to the text like Romans 1 to 5, but it's essential to be discerning. Allow the Holy Spirit time to minister through us. That's what Jesus did. Do you notice there when he, in I think it's John 11, where he goes there to the tomb? And he waits. It upset the family members. Jesus, only if you would have been here, my brother would be alive. Don't you think Jesus knew exactly what he was doing? He delayed. But it says when he arrived there and he saw all the tears, we have that wonderful passage, Jesus wept. Along with that, be careful not to become what I call a cookie cutter council that assumes everyone can only find a healing a certain way. For example, 5 stages of grief became very popular, still is very popular today. And I don't want to suggest there's not a lot of truth in it. Matter of fact, I don't want to suggest to you that people that go through the champion the 5 stages of grief, that they don't really care. Here's what they suggest they are. Stage number 1 is denial and isolation. Number 2, anger. 3, bargaining, trying to go back and forth, saying, God, if only I'd done this, maybe this wouldn't have happened. Depression, number 4, and acceptance. Here's the thing. Not everybody goes through the 5 steps of grief exactly like somebody says they ought to. You know, on May 27, 2008, when the boys got on the phone and we were just coming out of a time of vacation up in the mountains there in California, the Sierras, and I still to this day don't know exactly how Chad and Brett was in Ukraine and Chad was here in Maryland, and they called Dad. Something terrible's happened. I had seen all, my phone was just clogged almost because we had no phone signals up there in the mountains. When it came down, pulled over to the side of the road, and when they told me that news, I don't ever remember a time in my life weeping almost uncontrollably for 30 minutes. That was a hard, hard thing. The church was wonderful, got us to Denver right away. And you know, the church there in Visalia allowed us to take all the time we needed. The chairman of the elder board said, I'll just take whatever time you need. And so it took a full month. I wasn't back in the pulpit for a full month. But my grief was not the same as his dear wife, who not only had a little boy, but she had a little boy on the way. Yes, I had been his father for 25 years, but it didn't impact me in the same way that it was with his dear wife. And she did a wonderful job. She ended up writing a book on it and has now remarried a wonderful, wonderful man who's adopted those 2 boys, plus they've had one of their own. But be careful about cookie-cutter counsel. I've heard every kind of thing recently, the 4 types of personalities. How many remember that in the 70s, 80s? Everybody had, you're one of 4 types. You're either a sanguine, a phlegmatic, a melancholic, or a choleric. And this was huge in the evangelical world. You're a choleric. That's why you're kind of strong with people. Oh, that's why you're so quiet. You're a sanguine. Oh, you're melancholic. You really feel about things. Not realizing, hey, that stuff goes back all the way to Hippocrates back in the 3rd, 4th century B.C. And it gets popular. 5 types of love language. You're not speaking my language. And if you don't learn to speak my language, you got trouble. Be really careful about the cookie-cutter stuff that's out there. Not to suggest there's not some truth in it. I was amazed the other day when I read that they have, the psychological institution now has a little word frame that explains kids that are going through rebellion. You know what it's called? VDD. Volitional Defiant Disorder. I'm not kidding you. That's in the DSM-5, the Diagnostic Statistical Manual for Psychological Illnesses. And so a kid rebels now. We have a nice cookie-cutter explanation for it. My mother, if I told her, well, mother, the reason I rebelled, the reason I told you that lie is because I have VDD. She said, you know what? I've got a real quick cure for that. And she did that real well. It's called a strap. But be careful not to prejudge. Not everybody goes through it exactly like you think they should or the way you did. Principle 3. Now we finally get to the text. Stress that there is no greater hope than justification by faith. That's the text, Romans 5:1. Therefore, since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Martin Luther said of Romans 5, quote, "There's hardly another chapter which can equal this triumphant text." Ray Stedman said, "Romans 5 is a graduation exercise. It takes us from the elementary grades of Christian life into high school. Up to this point in the book of Romans, we've been dealing with birth truths. All of the first four chapters. You remember Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then he comes to that great chapter, chapter 5, justification by faith. And at this point in the book, we learn of the existence of the growth truths, the way to maturity and power, and the way to be effective in Christian services. This is why Romans 5, 1-5 is such an important text. The apostle begins with the word, therefore. And you remember from studying how to interpret the Bible, when you see therefore, what should you say? What's it there for? And as such, we should study the context and discern why it is there. The word therefore is the Greek word oon. Say oon. So when you see therefore, you say, what is oon therefore? It takes us back to chapter 4 where Paul carefully sets forth why justification and peace with God come not by works, verses 1 to 5, not by ordinances, verses 9 to 12, this is in chapter 4, and not by obedience to the law, verses 13 to 25, but by faith. The first three never bring genuine peace with God. You can't work your way to heaven. You can't have peace with God through your own works. And only faith in Christ will bring peace and the promise of abundant and eternal life, having been justified. Now, let me take you back into the first-year Greek classroom. You learn there what's called an aorist participle. It's not too difficult. The aorist tense simply identifies the justification as a one-time event in the past whereby the former unbeliever has been declared legally not guilty. I don't know about you, but is that something else when you think about it today, that there's a time in your life, those of you who are saved, and I think that's almost all of you, if not all of you, that God justified, said, not guilty. Are you glad for that? Think of it. The moment we repented of our sins and trusted in Christ for our salvation, God declared us righteous, never to change his mind. According to the Cambridge Dictionary, the French have an expression, fait accompli, which means, quote, an action which has already been done and which cannot be changed. As many have said, our justification by faith is one and done. Would you say it with me? It's one and done. You're not just saved 15 different times. You're saved once and for all. Oh, may we never understate and underapply this glorious truth as we come alongside those who are suffering. It is our greatest hope because our hope is in an eternal promise that goes far beyond any of the hopes for the present circumstances, as important as they may be. Praise the Lord. Paul declared in Philippians 3:8, "More than that, I count all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Jesus Christ my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them rubbish, so that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith." Don't you love that great hymn by Charles Wesley? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Don't ever get over the wonder of it. And instead of saying amen, would you say it with me? Wow, wow, wow. Wow, wow. Wow. Say it again. Wow, wow, wow. And you know, part of what happens is we grow in the Christian life and we come to church and we're asked by Mark to, hey, can you say amen to that? Pastor Chad, say amen. And sometimes we forget the wow of our salvation. I said, Lord, help me never to get over the wow. I love the transparency of Brother Roy. After we'd prayed from down there in the basement, I can still remember as we were going up the stairs, I wrote it down almost immediately in my journal because it said, if God doesn't spare my life, I know where I'm going. I just hope he gives me a little bit more time to enjoy him on earth. Don't you love that? That's an honest man. That's what Paul said in Philippians 1:21 in a nutshell, where the Apostle Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. So principle three, stress that there is no greater love than justification by faith. Principle four, emphasize there is no greater peace than to have access to God. Look at again verse 1 and 2. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Through whom, of course, refers to Christ. Barclay informs us the word introduction is used in an extra-biblical Greek sense for introducing someone to royalty. In other words, the New Testament passages, here's the verb that refers to bringing someone into another person's presence. There are several verses we could look up if we had time. Paul is the only author to use the noun form for introduction, and he uses it to refer to an ongoing access that he has to Christ. In Ephesians 2:18, he states, for through him, Christ, we, both Jews and Gentiles, have our access in one spirit to the Father. In Ephesians 3, 12 and 13, it writes, in whom we have boldness and confident access through faith in him. Therefore, I ask you not to lose heart at my tribulations on your behalf, for they are your glory, end quote. In other words, Paul is saying, hey, guys, look. Don't forget that no matter how difficult the tribulations are, we have access to the throne of grace. We can come boldly before the God of this universe. And then the last part of verse 2 says, we also exult in the hope of the glory of God. Exult is one of Paul's favorite words, and he uses it three times in the first 11 verses of this great chapter. The Greek word there is kachomai. Kachomai. It means to rejoice, to have confidence in, to boast of. Paul is saying that he not only has the hope of access to God, but being able to one day fully grasp the glory of Christ. That's what Paul prayed for in his high priestly prayer in John 17:24 when he said, Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me be with me for where I am, so that they may see my glory which you have given me. One day, we'll be stripped of all the things that dim our vision of his glorious majesty. Are you glad for that? All the stuff God's going to clear it up. The clouds will be rolled away. And we will see in verses 3 to 5, suffering even now aids in us stripping away those clouds. One of my favorite true stories is told about before the closing days of the Civil War. Here's Abraham Lincoln. They're in Washington, D.C. in the White House. And the story is told of a Southern soldier who had been freed from a prison camp because he was too wounded to return to active duty, and he was no danger. He was Southern, but he was a Confederate, but he was no danger to anyone. But he was seeking access to the president to intercede for his brother in a prison camp who was the sole support of their mother. But the White House guards would not let him in to talk to President Lincoln. He had no access. One day, the president's young son, Tad Lincoln, was walking near the White House and saw the wounded veteran crying as he sat on a bench. The boy went up and asked him what the matter was. The soldier explained that he wanted to get to see Mr. Lincoln to tell him about his brother, but the guards would not let him in. The president's son took the man by the hand, led him past the guards, who all saluted, and brought the man into the presence of his father. Don't you love that story? So here's a Confederate soldier wounded, the enemy of the North, of the Union. And he's crying out. He can't have access. But the president's son just walked right past the guards. Is that not a picture of what Jesus does for us? We have no access, no right to go to the Father on her own, but only because of what the Lord Jesus Christ has done on our behalf. Well, I could finish the sermon right there. Whoa. Every time I read that story. Principle 5. Point out to them the incredible benefits package. Look at verse 3. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Paul begins by telling the believers in Rome to exult, rejoice in tribulations. That's phlipsis, which means afflictions. From that word afflictions, it really means pressure. It's a suffering of body or mind, anything that burdens the spirit. But why, Paul, are you saying exult in tribulations? Because part one of the benefits package is perseverance. The Greek word there is hupomone, which means to abide under. The King James Version translates it as patience. And I think W. E. Vine is right when he says, patience grows only in trial. Most of us don't just learn patience vicariously, do we? We learn patience because God takes us through a trial. Pastor Stephen Cole, just retired from a church there in Flagstaff, Arizona. I just love his writings. And here's what he said on this passage. Quote, "But trials are a fact of living in this fallen world, so we all need to learn what God's word tells us about how to handle them. The problem is the biblical approach to trials is just plain nuts." That's what he writes. Paul says that he exults in his tribulations. Maybe we could explain him away as being a bit carried away. But then what do we do with Jesus? He tells us, according to Matthew 5, 11 and 12, "Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great." So Paul's point is, you don't develop endurance unless you go through trials. That's why, I don't know about you, I don't like signing up for this course. You don't have to endure when everything is going your way. It's not difficult to trust the Lord when you're experiencing nothing but blessings. But will you endure by faith when life is hard? Will you trust God and submit to his mighty hand when you lose your job or when you're going through a hard time in your marriage or when you're diagnosed with a serious disease? This part of the benefits package requires faith, and faith requires focus. We must learn to cooperate with God during our trials and suffering. I sometimes tell counselors, look, I'm very sympathetic and sorry about what you're going through, but may I encourage you to cooperate with God? If we do not cooperate with God, we end up doubling the trial. The trial is difficult enough. So resisting and not trusting God make it more difficult. I don't know about you. I only want to go through the trial one time. I'd like to learn from it, rather than resisting God, which is just common. Or people telling you, I'm sorry, you've got to go through all these stages. Maybe some of them you've got to go through, but not all. You cooperate with God, you might be surprised the peace that God gives. Principle 6, remind them that God uses trials and suffering to shape our character. Again, most of us are not ready to sign up for this package. I certainly have never asked the Lord if I could be the first in line. Now you watch it and we do the potluck. Will it take a whole lot of, who would be the first to go in line to start the potluck? I've usually got to hold my grandkids back a little bit. Because we love food. David Gutzig writes, "Most every Christian wants to develop character and have more hope. We may wish to have better character and more hope without starting with tribulations, but that isn't God's pattern and plan. We would rather have God just sprinkle perseverance and character and hope on us while we sleep." How many would like that? Wouldn't that be neat? You go to sleep tonight, and you're going to wake up in the morning, and you're going to learn how to, you've learned to exult in trials and tribulations. All of a sudden, you've got your wonderful man and woman of God with lots of patience. Doesn't work that way. We'd rather have God just sprinkle perseverance and character and hope on us while we sleep. Then we could wake up and be much better Christians, you're right. Then look at 3 and 4 again. "Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope." We must not overlook verse 3, this important word, knowing. Knowing. The Greek word here is a derivative of oida. Now, first year Greek class, I can still remember this, you're going to learn the difference between two basic words for knowing. One is gnosko, and the other one is oida. Gnosko is kind of like, don't touch that hot stove. And have you ever done that or seen your kids do it? Boy, they learn. And so gnosko is kind of comes from the process of learning. We've had enough of the hard knocks of life. But oida is more instinctive. It's a beautiful word. It says that because of certain things, now you know. If I were to ask you, how many of you know in spite of your trials, God is a good God? You know that. You don't have to be told that. You know. Wait, let me see your hand. I only saw two hands this entire, okay, that'll get you awake. All right. You know that. The perfect tense here indicates that this knowledge was given to the believers in Rome when they were justified by faith and continues into the present. This is called intuitive knowledge, oida. The unbelieving world does not have it, but every believer does. We have the same verb form in Romans 8:28. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God. We know. We instinctively know it. You become a believer, God's gonna work things together for good. The point here is that we deliberately focus on this vital truth that we intuitively know to be true. So, back in the early 80s, and so we'll get to hear Gail Jackson again Wednesday night, one of my wonderful mentors that God's privileged me to study under. And we were planting a church. The church was maybe about 10 years old. And one day he said to me, Alden, he said, I take a look at your family. And my father was 59 and a half, had moved from Oklahoma back to Denver where he had raised us. And God gave them a house right smack in the middle of his four children who were all raising their families. Nobody was more than 10 minutes away. And I've seen how God had just blessed that, the cousins having a strong impact on one another. And so, you know, Gail Jackson came from a place where most of his family, as I recall, weren't believers, and he looked and he saw all the blessings. He told me one day, he said, Alden, it's a matter of time, I think, before your family's going to have to go through some great suffering. I'm glad I listened to that. 1988, first wife got cancer, 11-year battle with cancer. 96, Kendra with that terrible car accident. 2008, loss of a son, 25 years old. And other sufferings along the way as well, not to mention the hundreds of people God has allowed us to come alongside and help. The point is this, God uses trials and suffering to shape our character. God didn't say, you know what? I want to leave the Lairds in this really nice, beautiful little setting. And I think of the suffering that we've had to go through, God has enabled us to come alongside others who've had to suffer the loss of a child, of a mate, of a family member, and on and on. Have you ever had to remind your children about something they already knew? Don't you remember? I told you not to touch that hot stove. They have to be reminded. They are still learning as adults. We are typically much more cautious as we have learned that touching a hot stove will bring pain. So I think Paul is saying here, look, you know this, and I'm simply reminding you that it's an established fact that trials and suffering bring about perseverance, and perseverance proven character, and proven character hope. Proven character. What an amazing statement. This is a single word in the original text that means something that has passed the test. Some of you probably know this, that in the desert south of Kingman, Arizona, there is a Ford proving ground. They put their cars and trucks through various tests to prove they will hold up in extreme situations. Once they pass the test, they can say, especially with respect to their trucks, Ford trucks are what? Built to last. That's been an expression they've been perpetuating for many, many years. They have proven their character. The point here is that we at the proper time want to encourage the suffering saint. Quote, my dear friend, I can't imagine what you're going through, but I want to encourage you that you can go through this trial and difficulty knowing that God will not waste your sorrows. It's one of the best books I ever read by Paul Bilheimer called Don't Waste Your Sorrows. God has given you sorrow. Don't waste it. God's got you in the learning school. God will not waste your sorrows. That you are not a flash in the pan Christian. That your faith and godly character have been proven. That you know God is going to somehow, in some way, work these things together for good. And then finally, principle 7. Underscore, if you're trying to help someone. But wait, there's more. How many have heard an advertisement? And this infomercial, and it was getting long enough, and it's just a matter of time. I know if I don't turn the channel, it's going to be, but wait, there's more. They're going to offer you 2-for-1. They're going to offer you free shipping. Well, here's the good news about God. Wait, there's more. God's unconditional love. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Scholars say that could be literally translated, hope does not make us utterly ashamed. The King James Version translates, and hope maketh not ashamed. The phrase is rooted in the Old Testament where the psalmist cried out in great distress, in you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried out and they were delivered. In you they trusted and were not disappointed. Or literally, they were not put to shame. David said in Psalm 25:3, indeed, none of those who wait for you will be ashamed. Kind of an amazing way to say it, isn't it? The sense here is that when we trust the Lord through trials, we have his stamp of approval. We have the joy of the abundant life, John 10:10, the hope of eternal life, John 3:16, because of God's love that has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. I think Martin Lloyd-Jones, the great preacher from England just prior to World War II, and he characterized this passage correctly, and I'm going to paraphrase what he said. The initial hope comes from understanding the blessing of being justified by faith. We begin the Christian life full of faith and hope. Then we get hit by difficult trials. We cling to God like we've never had to cling before. We prove his faithfulness, and he develops proven character in us as we endure. We come out the other side more certain of the hope of eternal glory with him than we were before the trials. Our hope is stronger because it has been tempered in the flames of affliction. You go down to the quote there in your notes. And actually, just before that, do you see the application question number 3? You want to read a great book by C.S. Lewis, The Problem of Pain. And here's what he writes. Pain plants the flag of truth within a rebel fortress. Why pain might still lead repentance. That God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pain. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Think about this whole world. If there was no pain, would there be any that would be seeking God? And so Lewis is saying that pain is God's megaphone. So it's important to remember that. But for the believer, I love here what Pastor MacArthur wrote. The more you suffer in this world, the brighter your hope becomes. The more you suffer for righteousness in the world, the brighter your hope becomes, because the greater will be your eternal reward. So as the Lord refines us and refines us through persecution or through chastening, he is more and more causing us to be able to endure and to be shaped into proven character. The tree shaken by the storm roots itself more deeply, and that's what happens in our lives. Now, this is an amazing statement. You may or may not agree with it. I had to think about it a long time. Salvation doesn't refine the character. It just plants the capacity. You get a hold of that truth, that will help you grow. Because there's so many people, and there's even false teaching. They say, oh, become a Christian, it's like your problems go away. I don't know about you. I've had the privilege of leading several people to Christ, and many of them told me, you know what, I've got more problems now since I've become a Christian. Why? Because Scripture says those who live godly in Christ will be persecuted. God doesn't give some kind of trial. He talks about the abundant life, yes. But it plants the capacity. The trials really do the refining, and we rejoice in tribulation. That's what's so wrong about much of the emphasis today. People seem to think that the Christian life should be a path in which you escape tribulation somehow. Everything needs to be immediately fixed. whether or not we're supposed to go to some miraculous path to find the miraculous answer to fix our problem, or some counselor to fix our problem, or some alteration of circumstances, the fact of the matter is, it is the very trials and tribulations of life that God uses to shape us, and we should embrace them with joy because they produce a greater and greater hope. They make you long for heaven more, and they will make eternal heaven even more glorious by increasing your eternal reward. So in closing, no, we're never going to be able to have a trouble-free life here on this planet. But we will have a trouble-free eternity. Let's do a little bit more than that. Let's do the wow again, okay? Wow, a trouble-free eternity. I don't know about you, but every single week, there's something goes wrong. I had an adjuster come out, look at my roof, and oh, maybe you've got, you know, maybe there you've got some mold and problems with the car, and oh, the light just went on. How many could tell with uplifted hand? You've had a few of those issues this week. Things just didn't go perfectly well. Wow. I want to find a number of you that things did go really well and get on your coattails. But Paul writes, he said, therefore we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying, yet our inner man is being renewed day by day. For our momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison, while we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Here's my closing illustration. I want you to picture that you're in a foxhole. You're trying to protect your platoon from the onslaughts of the enemy, and you take that very seriously. So you're there, you're in the cold, and you're eating K rations, but you're doing your job. All of a sudden, another soldier comes and taps you on the arm, and he says, John, guess what? He says, the sergeant says, you're going home. What? Yeah, going home. So he said, get your bag and your belongings and get on going back. You're going to get to go back to the United States, and you're going to get to have some country fried chicken on your mother's cooking, and you're going to get to have cake, and you're going to get to have ice cream too. And he says, I don't want to go. I like it here in this foxhole, eating these K rations. Now, folks, that really would be nuts, wouldn't it? And I would say for our brother Roy and brother Dave and those who've parted, I'm going to tell you today, they don't want to come back. They don't want to come back. My son Drew does not want to come back. He wouldn't want to come back. And that's what Scripture says, there's no weeping in heaven. Not that they wouldn't want to come back and help us. I don't want to come across that way. But that's why eternity's going to be so great. We're going to see a trouble-free eternity. And my friends, that's a wow, and a wow. And the older I get, the more I'm looking forward to that unconditional love and that trouble-free eternity. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for this marvelous text. Help us, I pray, Lord, to be careful to sometimes to go slow, take it nice and easy, to be careful not to prejudge. But help us, Lord, to stress the justification by faith we have and the access to Lord Jesus Christ, the incredible benefits package, and that you're going to use these trials and suffering to shape our character. And we have a trouble-free eternity to look forward to. Help us, Lord, as we go forth from this place to have that kind of hope. And all God's people said, amen.